Shabbat Shalom, Chag Sameach. A wise rabbi was once asked, why do grandparents and grandchildren get along so well? Because, the rabbi responded, scratching his perhaps new beard, they have a common enemy. As we gather at this Yisker hour, we remember parents and children, siblings and spouses who left this world too early. The eye never has its fill of seeing, Ecclesiastes reminds us. On this Yisker of Passover specifically, let us also take the time as well to remember our grandparents of blessed memory and the important role that grandparents play in the lives of their grandchildren. Parents might fulfill the mitzvah of telling the story of our exodus from Egypt, but grandparents and great-grandparents symbolize the history to their grandchildren and bring it to life in so many ways. At the Seder table just a week ago, I sat down next to my 96-year-old grandfather and remarked lovingly, though with some humor, about his age. Zadie, as we recall the exodus, will you tell my children, your great-grandchildren, what you remember about your time with Moses? I don't remember much about Moses, responded my grandfather, a Polish survivor of the Holocaust. But I do know what it is like to come out of Egypt. Indeed, a survivor of ghettos and concentration camps knows about suffering. So began an opportunity for my grandfather to teach my children about his experience of slavery and redemption. There's something special about the relationships between grandparents and grandchildren. Hearing our grandparents' stories, basking in their love, and benefiting from their wisdom are precious, nurturing experiences that cannot be duplicated. King Solomon taught that a threefold cord is not easily broken. A family is indeed blessed when it has three generations living at the same time. As we well know, in healthy relationships, when this loving relationship between grandparents and grandchildren prevails, even the grave cannot sever it. The memory remains forever. There's been much conversation lately about the significance of Minhag Avotenu, the customs of our ancestors, our grandparents. In the weeks leading up to Passover this year, newspaper and social media were abuzz with the Kitniot controversy. As Passover shopping season began, a teshuva, a legal decision from the Conservative Movement's Committee on Jewish Law and Standards, permitting the consumption of Kitniot for Ashkenazi Jews on Passover, became the conversation du jour. What is the Kitniot controversy? Though I'm on record opposed to the decision, the conservative movement gave permission for conservative Jews of Eastern European descent to break from an 800-year-old tradition of avoiding on Passover the eating of rice, buckwheat, kasha, millet, beans, lentils, peas, sesame seeds, mustard, corn, green beans, snow peas, sugar snap peas, chickpeas, soybeans, sunflower, and poppy seeds. Of course, for many Sephardic Jews, kitniot are perfectly kosher and legitimate parts of the Passover diet. For some, even their favorite and most memorable Passover foods contain kitniot. But for Ashkenazi Jews, avoiding kitniot is a long-standing Passover tradition that has no practical differentiation from the prohibition against eating chametz. It's true, after all, that the Torah permits foods in the kitniot category while prohibiting chametz. And of course, chametz is narrowly defined as any food made from or that has come into contact with wheat, barley, oat, spelt, and rye that may also have been exposed to water. The actual reason, then, that Ashkenazi Jews began prohibiting the eating of kitniot while still permitting the possession of and benefit from those foods has become lost to history. The Mishnah Brura, a Jewish legal compendium composed by Rabbi Yisrael Meir Kagan of Poland in the 19th century, cites three reasons for the minhag, the custom of avoiding kitniot on Passover. He writes, kitniot are harvested and processed in the same manner as chametz. Kitniot may be ground into flour and baked just like chametz, so people may mistakenly believe that if they eat kitniot, they can also eat chametz. And three, kitniot may have chametz grains mixed into it, so people who eat kitniot may inadvertently be eating chametz. And indeed, as we came to find out right before Passover, that much of the white rice we eat has actually been processed with chametz, and thus prohibited both to Sephardic and to Ashkenazi Jews. In 21st century America, an era in which food production is well monitored and food packages well labeled, most of those reasons for avoiding kitniot no longer hold validity. Rather, like the reason we still maintain Yom Tov Sheni, the extra days of holidays like Sukkot, Shavuot, and Passover that we celebrate an eighth day of today, as well as a variety of other customs, we are committed to maintaining Minhagei Avotenu, the customs of our ancestors, unless, like our fierce commitment to egalitarianism, there is a compelling reason to veer from those customs. You see, whether an Ashkenazi Jew should or should not eat kitniot is not a matter of halakha. It's not a question of Jewish law. It's a question of minhag, of customs, of tradition. That is to say, in a world in which most Jews find plenty of ways to break away from tradition and lots of self-justifications to veer from the customs of our people, why in the world would the conservative movement want to encourage Jews who on Passover become a little more fervent in their traditional observance to become less so? At Passover time especially, but really at any time throughout the year, there's power in participating in the laws and traditions of our ancestors. I'm reminded of a story about Rabbi Eliezer Silver, one of the first American rabbis to enter the liberated concentration camps. Rabbi Silver had learned that some Jewish children had been hidden in monasteries and baptized, and he made a pledge to seek them out. The rabbi traveled to a hermitage in the Alsace-Lorraine region of France, where he was told that Jewish orphans were hidden. The monk who was in charge, however, insisted that there were no Jewish children on the premises. Rabbi Silver asked for a list of refugees. Since the rabbi was wearing the uniform of a U.S. Army colonel, the monk obeyed him. Among the list of refugees, the rabbi noticed some Jewish-sounding names, but the monk assured the rabbi that all of these children were Germans. Not at all convinced, Rabbi Silver said that he would return to speak to the children in the evening. That night, he returned in the company of two aides. They entered a high-ceiling dormitory and, seeing the children all around them in their beds, began singing, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Suddenly, from under the covers of six beds in the room, little voices were heard. They started to sing the Shema with him. They remembered it from their mommies and their daddies, from their Zadies and from their Bubbies. And with tears flowing down their cheeks, they ran to the rabbi. These are my children, the rabbi exclaimed. I'm taking them to their home in Eretz Yisrael. When we are most lost in life, it is the traditions of our youth to which we turn to find grounding, to find strength, to find direction. Certainly parents have an obligation to impart traditions to their children. Rebecca and I say the Shema with our young children every day. But the weight of transmitting the power and meaning of traditions, of Jewish traditions, falls not on the parents, but on the grandparents. In the Torah, the book of Deuteronomy, Moses told our ancestors, "Remember the days of old, consider the generations long past. Ask your father and he will tell you, your elders, and they will explain to you." The word associated with a parent telling his child is the same as the word for Haggadah, a telling. Why then does it suggest after the Haggadah, after the telling, that one should consult his elders as well? Because knowing Jewish traditions might require only a teaching. Understanding and incorporating Jewish tradition into our lives, though, requires the wisdom and love that a grandparent can best communicate. Not just with words, but with sleepovers and with hugs, with special trips to the kosher butcher, to the synagogue, and even to the cemetery, with trips to Israel, and perhaps even, if you're able, supporting your grandchildren in day school or in religious school. A grandparent can provide the memories which imbue our traditions with meaning, so that later in life those traditions can offer us grounding, strength, and direction. After all, grandparents symbolize the entirety of Jewish history itself. You grandparents symbolize to your grandchildren the realness of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. You symbolize all the blessings that has come before, and you give us the hope that an even better tomorrow lies ahead. And if you yourself are not yet a grandparent, borrow someone else's children and grandchildren and play that role for them. At this Yizkor Hour, let us recognize and give thanks for the important role that grandparents play in our lives. Let us consider their lives and the legacies they left with us. Moreover, let us strive to leave legacies of our own with our grandchildren. Legacies full of laughter and of love, of passion and compassion, of lives dedicated to and perpetuating a new generation of Minhagei Avotenu, the customs and laws of our ancestors. Remember the days of old, the Torah tells us. Consider the generations long past. Ask your father and he will tell you, your elders and they will explain to you. May God bless and strengthen the grandparents in our midst today. May God remind us now too of our own grandparents, the role they played in our lives, and the legacies of tradition and of character they sought to transmit to us. During the season of our freedom and of our memory, may we merit to communicate the lessons we inherited from our grandparents to our children and to our grandchildren as well. Kein yehi ratzon, may this be God's will. And let us say together, Amen. We transition now to our Yizkor service and dedicating the plaques of a new season. Our God and God of all generations, author of life, our lives are in your hands. We are but sojourners upon this earth. We recognize that the same fate awaits us all, whether we are simple or wise, rich or poor, great or small. Death levels all distinctions. We are all equal in death. The memories of those who are gone from us should stir us to better living, to kind words, to just and noble deeds, and to lofty ideals, so that when the time comes for others to remember us, we may have left the world better than we found it. Thus shall life become a song to immortality. Thus shall life be master over death. As we dedicate these memorial plaques today, we recall the prayer of Rabbi Morris Adler. We thank thee, O God of life and love, for the resurrecting gift of memory, which endows thy children fashioned in thine image with the godlike sovereign power to give immortality through love. Blessed be thou, O God, who enables thy children to remember. We dedicate these plaques now to all whose names they will bear. Just as they gave life to their children, along with the tools to find the meaning that life holds, so too will we look upon these names and be reminded that life is a precious gift, and that there's much meaning in life for those who will to see it. It is not death, but rather life, that will claim our thoughts. And so now we will mark the dedication of these plaques, and when you hear your loved one's name read, please rise. Maxwell Bardenstein, Alan Burstein, Pearl Bellow, Audrey Horowitz, Edith Levine, Alvin Nachman, Thomas Nessel, Louis Parr, Harold Podolsky, Nettie Rubenstein, Esther Sherman, Esther Siegel, Hannah Silber, Chaim Silber, David Zirkin, and Mildred Zirkin. We dedicate these plaques to all whose names they will bear. In the presence of their extended family, we consecrate these plaques before you, God, source of all life, in the abiding faith that though death is inevitable, the memories of our loved ones will endure. May the memories of all of your loved ones be always for a blessing. And let us say together, Amen. You may be seated. We turn now in our Yisker booklets to page 2.
Mizmor LeDavid, Adonai Roi.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul, he guideth me on straight paths for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me.
Shivtecha umishantecha hema yenachamuni.
Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Taruch lefanai shulchan neged tzorarai.
Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies.
Dishanta vashemen roshi kosi revaya.
Thou hast anointed my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Achtov achesed yerdefuni kol yemei chayai.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Page 3. Some of us recall parents who watched over us, nursed us, guided us, and sacrificed for us. Some of us lovingly call to mind a wife, husband, or partner with whom we were truly united. In our hopes and our pains, in our failures and our achievements, in our joys and our sorrows. Some of us remember brothers and sisters who grew up together with us, sharing in the play of childhood, in the youthful adventure of discovering life's possibilities, bound to us by a heritage of family tradition and by years of togetherness and love. Some of us call to mind children, entrusted to us too briefly, to whom we gave our loving care, and from whom we received a trust that enriched our lives. So many of us recall beloved relatives and friends whose affection and devotion enhanced our lives, and whose visible presence will never return to cheer, encourage, and support us. Though they're gone, we're grateful for the blessings they brought to our lives. We're sustained and comforted by the thought that their presence in our lives remains an enduring blessing that we can bequeath to others. We can show our devotion to them by our devotion to those ideas that they cherished. O God of love, make us worthy of the love we received by teaching us to love you with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our might, and to spread the light of your divine love on all whose lives touch ours. Give us strength to live faithfully, for we are cheered by our confidence that you will not permit our lives to be wasted, but will bring all our worthy strivings to fulfillment. Page 4. Page 5. When I look upon the sunrise and anticipate the start of a new day, together, Yid Gadal, Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent. When I look upon my child, my spouse, my mother or father who loves unconditionally, Yid Gadal, Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent. When I look upon my home and all my material possessions, Yid Gadal, Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent. When I look upon old friends, my pet, even those co-workers who enliven my day, Yid Gadal, Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent. When I look upon the challah, my candlesticks, my kiddush cup filled with wine, Yid Gadal,
Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent.
When I look upon the night stars, the rolling waves, or feel the wind against my face, Yid Gadal, Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent. When I stand at the graveside, at Yisker, and at the yortzite of a loved one taken far too soon, still I say, Yid Gadal, Yid Kadash, great and holy is our heavenly parent. Thank you, dear God, for the gift of life and all that is in it, great and holy is our heavenly parent. Page 6.
In the rise
Please rise as the ark is opened, and we continue with our silent Yisker recitations, beginning on page 7 and continuing through page 12. Yizkor Elohim Nishmat Kol Acheinu. May God remember the souls of our brothers and sisters, martyrs of our people, who gave their lives for the sanctification of God's name. May God remember the souls of all of our brethren, men, women, and children of the house of Israel, who were slaughtered and suffocated and burned to ashes in the Shoah. May God remember the souls of our brothers and sisters in the state of Israel, who gave their life for the sanctification of the name of God, the Jewish people, and the land of Israel. May all of their souls be bound up in the bond of life. May they and all of our loved ones rest forever in dignity and peace, with fullness of joy, in the comfort of your eternal presence. And we say together, Amen. Amen. We turn now to page 15 and offer the memorial prayer.
Tachat kanfei ha-shechinah B'malot kedoshim Kedoshim ote-harim Kezohar ha-rakiya Mazhirim Lenishma Kol klei kodesh yavdu po, ule nishemot kol haile shizkarnu hayom, livracha, shehalechu leyolamam. Began Eden, began Eden, tehei menuchatam. Rachamim hastirim b'seiter kenofecha leyolamim utzeror b'tzeror achayim utzeror b'tzeror achayim et nishmotayim Adonai ונחלתם וינוחו בשלום וינוחו בשלום על משכבותיהם בשלום ונאמר אמן.
Exalted, compassionate God, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and the pure, to the souls of our loved ones who have gone to their eternal home. Merciful One, we ask that they find perfect peace in your tender embrace. May their memories endure, inspiring truth and loyalty in our lives. May their souls be bound up in the bond of life. May they forever rest in peace. And let us say together,
Amen.
And as we turn now to page 17, we offer the words of the mourner's Kaddish, giving thanks to God for the gift of life, for all those whom we have in our heart today. And we especially remember those for whom we're dedicating a plaque this morning. Maxwell Bardenstein, Alan Burstein, Pearl Bellow, Audrey Horowitz, Edith Levine, Elvin Nachman, Thomas Nessel, Louis Parr, Harold Podolsky, Nettie Rubenstein, Esther Sherman, Esther Siegel, Hannah Silber, Chaim Silber, David Zirkin, and Mildred Zirkin. In memory of all those whom we love and remember, page 17. Yitgadal v'yitkadash shemei Rabbah, b'alma divra kirutei v'yamlich malchutei, b'chayechon v'yomechon v'chaye dechol beit Yisrael, b'agala v'izman kariv v'imru amein, Yehei Shmei Rabbah Mevorach Le'olam Olmei Umaya Yitbarach V'yishtabach V'yitpa'ar V'yitromam V'yitnaseh V'yithadar V'yitaleh V'yitalal Shemei Rekudisha V'richu le'ela min kol birchata v'shirata, tushbechata v'nechamata, namiran mi'alma v'imru amen. Yehei shlama rabba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'imru amen. Ose shalom b'mromav, hu yase shalom, aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'imru amen. May the one who brings peace to the universe bring peace to us and to all Israel. And let us say it together. Amen. We return now the Sifrei Torah to the Ark. It will be closed, and then you may be seated.
Wait, we remember that.
Do you want to leave it out?
Remember me. Stay.
All right, pardon me. We will leave it out for one more minute as our choir concludes Yisker, page 16.
I'll never.